call us at 856-261-9018 or an email, questions@bftbc.org. Our 1 Corinthians chapter 7, they got down to verse number 2 last time, but let's read 2, 3, and 4 just as a background so we get the context. All right, 1 Corinthians 7, beginning 2 to 4, beginning at verse 2. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, let every woman have her own husband. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife hath not power of her own body, but the husband, and likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife. All right, to avoid fornication. We decide to define fornication as what?
Sexual morality.
Sexual relations on the part of unmarried people, especially. The word porneia's got a lot of different uses, but generally speaking, in our culture, adultery, sexual relations on the part of married people, fornication, unmarried. To avoid that, what is the way to avoid it in verse 2?
Your own husband
and your own wife. That's right. So, in other words, is this two women and two men together?
No.
No. Does the Bible teach sodomite marriages?
No.
No. It's against sodomite marriages. And those of us who believe the Bible, we've got to speak out against this crazy, crazy sin. It's wickedness. And, of course, we read this morning that they're thinking of making a law that churches that call homosexuality a sin, they're going to close them down. So take the pastors, find the pastor, put him in jail. That's what they're thinking right now. See, horrible. This sodomite group is strong, and they're strong. And of course, I believe the president's a sodomite himself. I believe he's married to a woman that's transvestite. She's a man, but she's dressed like a woman. But he is a sodomite. He's a homosexual, been that for many years. So anyway, this is every woman have her own husband, every man have his own wife. Not somebody else's wife. Yes. John.
Michelle's transvestite, then who are the natural mothers of her daughters?
Adopted. They just adopted them. They're just adopted, no problem. They didn't have any marriage at all. They're just adopted people. All right. So, of course, that's what that church that they went to originally, Jeremiah Wright.
Right, yeah.
See, he trained a bunch of homosexuals in his church, males and females, lesbians and homosexual males. And so he put them together. He got them, one looks like the other, and started petting them up. He was all a master of that. So he did that very interesting. All kinds of that. So Obama was one of those. Of course, in Chicago, they have these places where the homosexuals gather. He's a part of it, very part of it. It's just a documented that he's a homosexual. So he's all for this. He's pushing. I remember originally he said marriage is one man and one woman. Remember he said that several years back. Now he's all changed. He's changed. That's right. So it's got to be the anybody you want, men to men, women to women. But scripture is very clear, isn't it? Every man have his own wife, that's feminine. Every woman, feminine, have her own husband, that's masculine. So that's what marriage is. Then in verse 3, what should the... Yeah, Anna, I'm sorry.
Well, I mentioned this last week, but I would mention it again.
Good.
Verse 2...
Repetition is the mother of learning. Repeat.
Verse 2 disproves polygamy because... It's every man has his own wife, and every woman has her own husband.
Yes.
So it indicates one and one.
One and one, not many. You're right. And that'll come next. That'll come next. After this side of my marriages, they're going to honor polygamy. Everybody can marry anybody they want to, as many children, many husbands, many wives. That'll come next.
There's already a lawsuit on that.
Already a lawsuit. Yeah, I suppose that's interesting. I think I read that somewhere, too. So
Idaho, Montana.
Is there, they're moving along, all kinds of filthiness in regards to marriage, not biblical marriage. So now, render. What is the duty in verse 2, verse 3 rather, of the husband? What's the duty? Yeah, John?
I think, believe me, it's legal in Utah.
Is it? Well, they got a bunch of, you know.
It's practice.
Whether it's legal or not, it's practice. Yeah. What's in verse 3, what's the duty of the husband?
To love his wife, but also to be the head. You know.
In Ephesians, it's love your wife. That's the duty there.
In other words, to be the head.
That's in Ephesians also.
To be the head, make decisions.
All right, but in verse 3, what's the duty here? That's Ephesians. That's right, Paul. In Ephesians, that's exactly what the husband's duty is to be. What's the duty here?
Well, he's supposed to render to her due benevolence.
Due benevolence. Now, there's, well, this is probably due married love, sexual relations. That's probably what it's referring to here. And what is the wife's duty, according to verse 3?
Likewise.
The wife to the husband. So, in other words, this married love is part of marriage. And these are the man's duty, the wife's duty. Then in verse, did we read 4? We didn't read 4, did we? Let's read 4, 5, and, excuse me, we did read 4. We had 2, 3, and 4. Okay, verse 4. We read 2, 3, and 4. All right. In verse 4, what does it mean the wife hath not power of her own body? What's that mean? The wife hath not power of her own body.
They're to give to each other. There's not to be, they're not to withhold love to their husband.
All right. Power in what sense?
Authority.
Authority, exclusive authority. In other words, when you're married, husband and wives, the first part, wife doesn't have authority or power over her own body. But who does have the authority over her body?
Husband.
In verse 4, the husband. And then likewise, what about the husband?
Same thing.
He doesn't have power or authority over his body, but who does?
The wife.
So there's got to be mutuality in married love, biblical married love, scriptural married love, a mutuality. And there's not. So then we rest read verse 5, 6, and 7 together. Defraud ye not one the other, except it be with consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your incontinency. But I speak this by permission, and not of commandment. For I would that all men were even as I myself, that every man hath his proper gift of God, one after this manner, and another after that. All right, so in verse 5, what's the negative command here? Who's the, first of all, who is the ye referred to? Ye, defraud ye.
Probably
husband and wife.
Yeah.
What does defraud mean?
The force.
Without fraud.
No, with the force's way or vice versa. It would be the force's will.
Well, that's possible. What did someone say over this? Defraud means what?
The footnote says, without, by fraud, rob, cheat.
Okay. What does someone say over here?
I didn't say anything.
Well, someone said.
But I just did. Oh. Just a moment ago, but not before. No.
No. I think someone said deprive. Was it you, Barbara? Oh, okay. Someone up that area. So, in other words, deprive. Don't deprive you one the other. Now, deprive you of what? Do you think?
Self-control?
Well, possible. What else in the context? In verse 4, defraud you not what? Of what?
Sexual marriage.
It's sexual rights and married love. See, the wife shouldn't defraud the husband. Husband shouldn't defraud the wife. Defraud, you're not one or the other. And now, there's some exceptions here. There's 3 or 4. What's the first exception? Or first rule as far as depriving or defrauding?
Consent.
What does that mean?
Consent.
What does that mean?
You agree.
Husband agrees? No married love? Wife agrees? The consent, that's the first thing. Consent. What's the second provision? A requirement for a time. No, what before that? For a time. What does that mean?
Well, let's just go apart for a while to pray. And
for what? Yes. Well, for this for a time. In other words, it's a seasonal thing. Is it permanent?
No.
And we have some friends that have not had married love for years. Honey, how many years has it been? A friend of yours.
By now, I suppose. I don't know. I didn't ask.
Well, how many, roughly?
At the time, it was 5 years.
5 years. See, is that what the for a time means?
No.
No, it means for a season, a brief time. In other words, consent is the number one, for a time, a season, number two. And then what's the third purpose or provision here?
Fasting and prayer.
You give yourself, in other words, a proper reason. A proper reason. We don't have fasting and prayer necessarily in this age in which we live. They did in that time when Paul was writing this. The Jews always had fasting and prayer. Some Christians still have fasting and prayer, but there's no command, I think, in the New Testament in regard to that. But some valid reason. Consent, a time, valid reason. Whether fasting and prayer, in other words, time to think things over. And then what's the next provision in verse 5?
Come together again.
What does that mean?
Resume their relationship.
Resume your marital love. come together again. Then what's the final word about this in the last part of that verse?
So you don't tempt it.
So that Satan doesn't tempt you for what? Inconstancy. In other words, no married love, whatever. Satanic temptation. So these are the provisions that the Lord gives down in his word here. Don't deprive consent, brief time, good purpose, presume, contemporary other end, the reason so Satan doesn't tempt the husband or tempt the wife in any way. All right, so then in verse number 6, what does Paul say? What does he mean, I speak this by permission? God gave him permission, opinion out of commandment. In other words, there wasn't a particular command in the Old Testament or New Testament, but it's by permission, as far as husband and wife. Now, he explains that. Did we read number 8 yet?
No, not yet.
Not yet.
We haven't gotten to
number 7. Oh, right. Did we read 7, though, did we?
Five or 6?
Did we, yes, we did. Read 6? 7, okay. What does it mean, I would? What does would mean in this case?
It's
I would.
That's my desire.
Wish.
I wish. That's right. See, it's my desire. I wish. I want that all men were what?
Like himself.
And how was Paul at this time?
He was single.
He was single. Now, many people believe Paul, before this, was married. He was a part of the Sanhedrin. One of their requirements is they were married men, but his wife apparently died. Now, people don't, there's no scripture on that, but that's my belief. He knew all what marriage was. And but now his wife is gone and he's no longer married. Now other people say, well, he never was married in the first place. Well, whatever is the case, at least what does he want to happen as far as his wish is concerned in verse 7?
Sort of
all men as myself. In other words, not having a wife. Did Paul have a wife at this time?
No,
he may have had one before, but not at this time. He did not have one. But then he says, every man has his proper gift of God. What does that mean?
Man has a different calling to different, be married.
Different calling to be married or not to be married. Paul.
Paul, I believe, also said that not every man should receive. It also said in Thessalonians there, it also said that not every man I'm trying to remember what, I know what it is, but I'm trying to. In other words, not every man should receive, everyone should receive this, I believe is what he was trying to say.
Mm-hmm. So, see, now, I think the Lord said in one of the Gospels, there's sometimes eunuchs that are born eunuchs, no sexual relation of any kind. Some made eunuchs of men. Some wrong with it. Some made eunuchs of men. Others have a special gift of God that to remain on their own without marriage. But the gift of God, in other words, every man has a proper gift. Now, do you think all the Roman Catholic priests are without having sex with either each other or women, the nuns? No. In fact, there's a whole seminary I read up on it several years ago, a whole seminary that's made up of homosexual priests, homosexual priest seminaries. The Pope, he doesn't take a stand on that. They did knock out one man. I said that in the news this last time. And the priest, he had another man right there, picture the priest and another man, and he was kicked out of the Roman Catholic Church somewhere, but not everybody. He says, he's asked a question. The Pope's asked a question. What do you think about homosexual marriage? Well, he's had some little fancy word meaning. If he were to clamp down on all the nuns that are lesbians and all the priests that are homosexuals that either have sex with one or the other man or with the nuns, he'd have very few left in the whole Roman Catholic system. Terrible. Yeah, John.
The previous two popes before him took a stronger stand on homosexual priests and homosexual marriage. They were more conservative.
The other priest, the other pope. Yeah. So, in other words, every man according to the gift of God. Now, I don't know. There's been talk in the Roman Catholic Church of changing that and permitting priests to marry and nuns to marry. I don't know whether it ever comes to pass, but, I mean, there have been talk about that. See, you've heard of that, perhaps. It's been Tammy and then Vaughn.
Didn't they at one time marry? It seems like they did.
Yeah, I think so, in the early days, before they put that prohibition. They used to have marriage. Yvonne?
Yeah,
I read something recently when that question came up, and it said that if the priest married, then they would have children, then they would have to be educated and go to college, and how, mm-hmm. how expensive that would be for the Catholic Church to educate all those children and take care of the wives and the children. Did anyone ever, I heard that.
Yeah. I read that too.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Which I thought was a sort of a far-fetched thing.
Yeah.
They have so much money for other things.
Millions and billions. Roman Catholic Church is one of the most richest organizations in the whole world. I don't know how many billions, but they got billions. So it's interesting. So everyone according to the gift of God. Now, let me see. That's in verse number, where were we, seven? Yeah. Now, one after this manner, one after that. What do you think that means? This manner and after that. Verse seven, the last part. Well, maybe one.
More than one gift.
Yeah, yeah. Tammy? I mean, Anna?
1 Timothy 4 I'll read the first few verses. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience sealed with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from meats, which God created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth.
Yes, that sounds like Rome, doesn't it? Forbidding to marry. See? Now, abstain from meats too, except for, especially Friday, and what's this thing and that thing. But could that possibly be one after this manner to marry, mm-hmm. one after that manner not to marry? Mm-hmm. It's a different gift to marry and not to marry.
That makes sense.
Yes. In other words, are all born again, saved, true Christians, all true Christian women, are they all married?
No.
No. All true, genuine Christian men, are they all married?
No.
No. So, you see, they've got to figure that out themselves. It's not as easy as all. In fact, the ones that are Christians, born-again Christians, that do marry, are they, many of them, end up in divorce.
Some of them.
No, I'm talking about born-again, genuine Christian people. Yes.
Divorce
in the church is no different than it is in the world. That's right. Yeah, John?
Since divorce is a sin, since God hates putting it away, why is it that the federal government, even back in the old days when all the other sins weren't tolerated like they were, why is it that divorce has always been allowed? Why has there ever been a ban on divorce?
As far as the Roman Catholic Church, you mean?
No, as far as in government? America, why is it that the Congress, the President, the Supreme Court, throughout all these years of America, why is it they never put in laws to ban divorce? Divorce ought to be banned.
Yeah, well, of course, Supreme Court and the government and everybody else, a lot of things, scripture, morality, they don't believe any of it, see? Whether it's against homosexuality, whether it's adultery, whether it's fornication, they're all for any of it, see? All these states, many of them, Yvonne. There used to be a law against sodomy. It was a law against it. Still, in some states, it still is. Yeah, yeah, fine.
Well, when we were younger, parents, they didn't get divorces. Married people, they stayed together. So there was some, and if there was a divorce, it was whispered.
Mm-hmm.
It was whispered.
Yeah.
And I remember a beautiful girl. That she was a grade under us, and I was on the bus with her, and she whispered, when I asked her about, you know, her mother and father, she whispered that they were divorced.
They whispered, yeah.
You know, and
it was a shame in the early days.
Your mom, your sister was divorced.
Yes.
She divorced her husband.
Mm-hmm. One of my sisters, the younger sister. Mm-hmm.
And your mother told me that that's the worst, I don't know if she used this word, but the worst thing that ever happened to her, tragedy, that her daughter got divorced. At that time.
The olden days, today, I don't think a lot of people don't care about it. Yes, Barbara.
The law was pro-marriage because you had to have a reason, adultery or whatever, to get divorced. And unless you could prove it, you couldn't get the divorce.
Yes.
Now there's no fault.
No fault
at all. So it doesn't make any difference. You don't need a reason. It's just we're
that's,
done.
That's right.
When did the no fault come into play? In the 60s?
Long time.
70s in there, yeah.
Okay.
But it's when the no fault came in, because before that it was pro-marriage.
All right, so, fine.
People that don't, a woman that doesn't want to be divorced, her husband can divorce her
regardless.
Without her consent or anything, yes. I think. Mm-hmm. Yes. The same way if a man, if a woman wants to divorce her husband, she can just get a divorce.
Right.
And it's really sad.
It's a sad thing.
So people are constantly the problem is they're marrying the wrong one, but you don't really know it's the wrong one until you're married, I guess.
That's true.
But anybody they married might have been the wrong one.
But once you got married, as far as the custom of the services of marriage in the past, what are some of the pledges that they say that they're going to obey?
Who?
The people that are being married, husband and wife.
Love, honor, and cherish.
Love, honor, and cherish. Till death us do part.
Sometimes they
leave that off now, yeah. But years ago used to say that, see. And they don't believe that anymore. Yes.
He was
going to
say something.
Go ahead, Pastor Dan.
It slipped my mind, I'm sorry.
All right. So, anyway.
Well, when you think of it, say it.
It's off topic, so.
No.
Is.
Can he say that?
Yes, he can say it off topic. Lots of things off topic.
I don't know if they've picked the wrong one. They just don't have a commitment.
That's exactly right.
Make marriage work.
Yes. See, if they say till death us do part, no matter how difficult it is, whether battling and fighting and disputing and difference of opinion, so what? You stay together anyhow, see? And you work things out, see? I mean, no two people are the same, are they? They're not all agreeing on everything. There's differences in doctrine. So, Yvonne?
Then there's the cases where a woman becomes pregnant and she's not married, but she is going to have a baby.
Mm-hmm.
And then they get married. And the man really never really loved her.
Mm-hmm.
I could name names, but I'm not going to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, go ahead.
They should still stay married, right?
Yeah.
Jake, just a minute. Go ahead, Ma.
And then they do stay married, but the man really never loved her.
Mm-hmm. Then they get divorced.
Yes, and then they have to get a divorce. And they shouldn't have gone together before they were married. But
right.
So I don't know if it's better for the woman to have the baby and not be married. At least she's not married, forcing a man to marry. But then there's all the humiliation. It used to be humiliating.
Used to
there's
be.
Nothing now.
But
nothing
it doesn't
now.
Seem to be yeah. now.
All right, Jacob from Texas. Go ahead, Jacob.
Yes, sir. I just want to tell you all hello, and
hi.
Thanks so much, Pastor Waite, for the sermon and the Bible teaching. But on this issue of the no-fault divorce, if I remember correctly, it was a communist feminist woman named Betty Friedan that pushed all this. Gloria Steinem and one other. I do not recall the third one, but Betty Friedan is the main one.
Yes.
If you check into that, you'll find out that the destruction of the family and they're very anti what they call patriarchy. And
matriarchy.
The whole thing. Yeah, the destruction of Western civilization. She was a communist.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you. Let's wave to Jacob from Texas. Thank you, Jacob, for talking to us. And call again anytime.
She couldn't hear what he said.
Oh, repeat, Pastor Dan.
He listed the names of three people, Gloria Steinem.
Betty Friedan.
Betty Friedan, that were instrumental in this destruction of the family.
Yes. And the communist inclinations and so on. So, yes, well, that's interesting. No, in other words, see, my wife and I have been married 67 years. Now, we're not perfect. We fight, we battle.
We stop now getting along.
Well, I thought I was getting along long before just now. But maybe that's true, not her. Anyway, but we're together. And we're going to stay together. This is a determination, Pastor Dan said. It's not a question of this or that. It's, are you really, what did you say, what was your word for?
Committed.
Committed. Committed to this thing and keeping your word till death us do part. And that's, happy marriages can be made, especially if they're saved and born again Christian people. They ought to get together, follow the scriptures and the word. Now that's easy. Yeah, Bill.
The Lord keeps his covenants forever.
Yes, he does.
He's the unconditional ones.
Right. Tammy, did you have your hand?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. So, in other words, we got down to verse number 7, this manner, that manner. Did we read 8 yet? We haven't read it. Okay, let's read 8, 9, and 10 together. I say therefore to the unmarried and widows, it is good for them if they abide even as I am. And if they cannot contain, let them marry. For it is better to marry than to burn. And unto the married I command, not I, but the Lord, let not the wife depart from her husband. All right, verse 8, I say to the unmarried and widows. What is a widow? Husband died, they've been married. What does he suggest? What is his opinion?
Stay
unmarried. Stay unmarried, even as I. In other words, that's why I believe Paul was married.
Yeah.
See, he was a widower. And as I say, some of the regulations they say in the history books, that biblical history, that members of the Sanhedrin had to be married. They couldn't have single men, and that was married men. So apparently, and what he says here, his wife probably died. Now he's single. You're going to abide the same. See, that's why he says, abide unmarried, even as I. Well, that's what at least I believe. Other people, other things, perhaps. Then in verse number 9, what's this mean? If they kind of contain, what's that mean? Contain.
In other words, I guess what he probably means, and I hope I'm phrasing this right, sexual desires that he can't, or urges that one may have.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it's probably what he, I believe it's what he, what he, what he was, what he meant to say, I guess.
Yes.
Sexual desires that they can't contain themselves.
Yes. In other words, if they, that is either men or women. See, sometimes the women cannot contain. Sometimes the men cannot contain, refuse, fulfilling their sexual desires. If they can't, then what is the requirement? What is the suggestion in verse 9? If that's the case, let them marry. Now, in other words, that's the thing. Marriage is honorable and all. The bed, marriage bed, undefiled, as I said. But God will judge the whoremongers and the adulterers. God will judge. So let them in. Then what's the last part of verse 9 mean?
Let not the wife depart from her husband?
No, in verse 9, yeah.
They're all verses.
Yeah. Let them marry. Better to marry than to burn in this lust and this desire, this sexual desire. Either the man or the woman, whatever it is. Some women have more sexual desire than men. Some men have more sexual desire than women. But whoever it is, better to marry. Does he believe in marrying divorce?
No.
No, stay married. Marriage forever. Yes, fine.
What do you actually do to that verse, though, with the divorced people? But if they can't, I can let them marry, so it's better to marry than to burn, like a divorced person.
Well, that's up to them, the decision that they make.
Well, the verses, it explains it later on in this chapter.
Yeah, later on in the chapter. Yeah, later on we'll get to that. We'll get to that. All right. Now, we read 10, didn't we? Did we read 10?
Yes, we read 10.
Okay. Now, what does he say to the married? What does he say to married people? Verse 10.
Wife's not supposed to leave her husband.
All right. So, in other words, now, is it only the Paul that's saying that?
No. The Lord.
The Lord is very definitely on this. What does it mean not to depart from her husband?
Don't leave your husband.
Don't leave. Don't leave. Don't divorce. Don't get changed. Yes, fine.
What if your husband's a real unfaithful man and going around with the neighbors and wife and different people like that? And I'm thinking of someone now. Her father advised her, you better get a divorce because she could get diseased, the wife. Mm-hmm. What do you do? I know what the Bible says.
Well, the Bible doesn't take that up. That's the answer.
I know.
It says, verse 10, let not the wife depart from her husband.
Right.
Yeah.
The husband, so apparently this situation is...
He departs.
He's the one that's leaving.
Mm-hmm.
But he comes home.
Yes. Well, as I say, it's not a lot of these things, morality is not always spelled out specifically in the scriptures of the Bible. So that's your decision, whatever they do. I mean, first of all, the husband never should go on with other women. That's the number one. Sinful, wicked husband, even though he claims to be a Christian. I know what you mean. He shouldn't be fraternizing and having sex with these other women. I know. And he could get all kinds of disease, venereal disease, bring it back to the wife and so on. So separation is maybe called for, and that's something, but divorce is different. Separation, they can get a separation, they don't have to divorce, they can separate. Now, look, go ahead, let's continue. What does verse 10 say? The Lord and Paul agree, what in verse 10?
Let not
the wife depart. What does it mean, depart?
Leave
her husband. We've mentioned that. All right. We haven't read 11 yet. Have we read 11 yet?
No.
Let's read 11, 12, and 13 together. But and if she depart, let her remain unmarried, or be reconciled to her husband. And let not the husband put away his wife. But to the rest speak I, not the Lord. If any brother hath a wife that believeth not, and she be pleased to dwell with him, let him not put her away. And the woman which hath an husband that believeth not, and if he be pleased to dwell with her, let her not leave him. Right, verse 11. If she depart, who's the she refer back to?
The wife.
The wife. What is the requirement? Two requirements, two things she can do.
Not married.
I'm married, yeah, Paul?
Doesn't it say in this passage here where a man, it is, they're not, in other words, if a husband or wife leaves, that, I'm trying to remember where I read it, where it is, they're not in bond, and they're not, in such case, they're not in bond, I'm trying to remember what it is now.
In bondage, that's a lot of people use that to justify divorce and remarriage. I don't believe that's the meaning of that bondage. They're not in bondage. In other words, they do as they wish.
Where's bondage?
Well, that's in another
verse.
Another verse, another chapter.
This chapter, down a few verses.
We'll get to that when it comes up, Paul. I don't believe that's what the meaning is, but in verse number 11, what are the two things that are to be true if the wife does depart?
Just to remain unmarried.
Number one, remain unmarried. Number two,
reconcile
her husband. See, there it is. Either remain unmarried the rest of her life. She wants to leave, that's what to do. Or be reconciled. What does that mean, reconcile?
Reunited,
get back together, and have a family again. And what's the last part of verse 11 say? What's the command there?
Don't let the husband divorce.
And that the husband divorce or put away his wife. So he should stay with her. He shouldn't be putting away. Yvonne?
I think only the husband could do a divorce. I think, but I'm not positive. It's been a while.
Well, there are rules, of course, for divorce and marriage, and usually it talks about husband, but by extension, be wife as well as husband. You know, the man, sometimes the Lord just talks about the man, sometimes just talks about the woman.
The legal system in those
days. Greek society, the women could divorce.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It was in Hebrew society that only the man could.
Okay, tell him.
Okay.
Yeah, I heard it.
See, so that's.
So, see, a lot of times, for instance, some things are applicable to both. For instance, about the divorce, the Lord Jesus said, stay together. If a man, well, what the man is told to do is the woman as well. See, they're both, but he uses the illustration as a man, for example, in some cases, the woman. And I think both principles are the same. I don't think he's singling out, although I realize in the Hebrew culture, the males were supreme and so on over the females, but I believe it's equal application myself.
I mean, I think the reason we're depart here for both male and females.
Yes.
I mean, if you go down further, it talks about use the word depart, it seems like it's either or.
Yes.
Yeah.
Let not the wife depart. And then in verse 11, Two possibilities, either remain unmarried the rest of her life or be reconciled to her husband. And then let not the husband put away his wife. Yeah, Anna.
Well, I expect there would be certain extreme circumstances in which the wife would depart and would be okay in departing. Like if the husband was being abusive, then she should probably not stay there. Although she
right.
Not
now,
divorce him either.
What is the difference between depart and put away?
Put away means divorce.
Put away is divorce and depart?
Leave.
Just leave.
Separate.
That's right, separate and leave for the time period, whatever, however long that is, months or years or whatever. So let not the husband put away or divorce his wife. And then 11, we read 11, didn't we?
Yes.
To the rest. What does that mean? I speak. The rest.
Who's ever left over?
Those that aren't married.
Those that aren't married, probably. Again, not the Lord. If any brother hath a wife that believeth not. Now, what does that mean, a wife that believeth not?
The saved and unsaved
saved
marriage.
Saved and unsaved marriage. Probably before they were, one was saved, they were both married, united in marriage, and then one became a Christian. And so, what is true of that people that brother, a Christian man, has a wife that believes not. What's the next part?
If she's pleased to stay.
Pleased to stay? What's what should be true? Don't put her away. Don't divorce her or put her away. So in other words, now the scriptures are clear about an unequal yoke. We shouldn't marry unequally. A Christian should not marry a non-Christian. That's an unequal yoke. But in this case, both were lost. They were married. One gets saved. See, but in that case, don't throw away the husband or the wife. Just stick with them. That's what it says, isn't it? So that's in verse 14. Why is that true? In verse, did we read? We read 13, didn't we? But not her leave him.
Yeah, we read it.
But we haven't talked about it. Okay, so let him not put her away. And the woman which hath an husband that believeth not, what should be true of her?
It'd be the same thing.
Probably this woman was saved after they were married, and husband wasn't yet saved. Let her not leave him. So that's not divorce, just to stay with him. See, and then we read 14, didn't we?
On 12, it says, and she be pleased to dwell with him, let him not put her away.
Uh-huh.
Divorced.
Right.
Yes.
And 13 is, if he be pleased to dwell with her, she is not to leave him.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a divorcing and a leaving
mm-hmm.
in this.
Yes. Not to divorce, so and one is not to leave, yeah.
Because a woman can't do the divorcing, I guess.
Yeah, but in Greek society, she could.
Yeah. Tammy.
But was it, were they, I guess this wasn't necessarily, we're talking Hebrew, mm-hmm. I'm not sure if we are now, but they would have been,
Gentiles, I think.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good point.
The men would have been, you know, the
economic breadwinner, so yes.
So.
Yes. Well, in either case, probably. Don't divorce or don't leave. It's, in other words, stay put, stay together. Either way, although there are differences in the way they phrase. You're right.
Yes,
Paul, and then fine.
I know where it says Pat. In certain cases where, you know, where divorce is permitted, like in fornication and stuff like that. But is it, I don't believe in divorce either. But what I'm saying is, in a case where husband or spousal abuse, should they divorce or just separate? In other words, if a spousal, you know, one beat, if a husband or wife, or if a wife beats on a husband or vice versa, what I'm asking, should they divorce or just basically separate?
Well, for Christians, know the word, they should just separate. If that's required, separation rather than divorce. Fine, it's something that Cass.
I forgot. It was important to.
Oh, Cass, go ahead.
I was just saying that was my case where I got saved before my husband, and I felt that the Holy Spirit wanted me to walk circumspectly, I guess that's the word.
Yes.
And I tried to, I don't think I really did the best job I could have, but I tried to be a good wife.
Yes.
Better than I was before.
Yes.
And it took a long time, but he finally came around.
And trusted the Lord.
Oh, that's nice. He noticed it.
Yes, Anna.
I'm such a good wife, you wouldn't notice the difference.
Right, Anna?
Well, it's a passage where it talks about a divorce for fornication. Wasn't that referring to during the...
Betrothal of the Jews.
Which we don't really have a comparison.
Right.
Because betrothal was stronger than engagement.
That's right. So that was in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, I think, verse 19. Chapter 6, 19 is repeated. And so that's a different situation. So I think that the Christian, if they're married, they should stick together and maybe separate. I don't know what to say on the total. See, there are lots of things, conditions that aren't in Scripture specifically. We just have to go with what's the best thing for the situation, I guess. What verse are we on now? Verse 14, was it? 14, was it?
Yes.
Okay. If the unbelieving husband is, the reason why they should stick together, if one's saved and one stays lost.
We've read it yet.
What is it?
I don't think we've read this yet.
Didn't read 14?
No, we haven't read 14.
Okay, let's read 14, 15, and 16 together. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Else were your children unclean, but now are they holy. But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God hath called us to peace. For what knowest thou, O wife, whether thou shalt save thy husband? What knowest thou, O man, whether thou shalt save thy wife? Verse 14. What's the reason why if a man is saved and the wife is still unsaved, the wife is saved, the man is still unsaved, what's the reason why they should stay together, according to verse 14?
Sanctifies
the marriage. Unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife. What does it mean, sanctified?
Set apart.
Set apart. All right, set apart by the wife. And what of the unbelieving wife?
Sanctified.
Same thing. Set apart by the husband. What about the children? Else were your children unclean, but now are they holy. What does that mean?
There's now someone that's saved in the family.
All right.
Or the husband and wife.
That's right. In other words, when they were both unsaved, both the wife and the husband, the children were just normal Christian. I mean, they were just unclean in the sense of they weren't Christian.
They didn't have any influence.
No influence. But now that one is saved, the other one, the children are become clean. They can be influenced by the saved person, either husband or wife. Let's see what Jacob has to say. Oh, Rob from Chicago. What's up?
Hi, Pastor Wade. Hi, everyone. Said the question why they should stay together if one's unsaved and the other is, and Peter answers that in 1 Peter 3:1.
Yes.
Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wise.
Yes.
1 Peter 3:1.
Very good, Rob. Let's wave to Rob in Chicago. Rob Winograd, Chicago. Thank you, Rob. That's true. In other words, by the godly living of the wife, like Cass mentioned with her godly living, the husband eventually... What was that?
I could have been better.
Well, all of us could be better than anybody do, but the husband eventually was saved. So this is the same way. By the conversation, don't put away your husband unsaved. That's very good. 1 Peter 3:1. It pays to live for the Lord and see what happens to the unbelieving husband or unbelieving wife.
There's a handout.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm here.
Oh, I'm sorry. Fine, yes.
I've heard, I used to teach husband love, yes. I used to, and afterwards, I heard years later that some teach that the believing husband makes the wife saved, or the believing wife makes the husband saved.
Is that true?
I've heard that.
Is it true?
No, it's not true.
Not scriptural, is it? What needs to be happening before someone can be saved?
I don't know how they get that.
That's to believe the Lord Jesus Christ and say it. Saving faith, genuine heart faith before you be saved. That's a strange thing. A lot of people maybe think that, just like some of the Presbyterians teach, that if you have a saved mom and dad, the children automatically are saved. Is that true?
This verse is one of the verses, I think. Was that? Maybe this is one of the support verses, too.
Well, possibly, but is it true that they're saved automatically? No. That's household salvation. Remember Paul in Acts 16:30-31, sirs, let's say it, what must I do to be saved? What do you say? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. Now that, they say, household salvation, but the next verse, the house believes in the Lord Jesus. In other words, if the house believes, the children, they can be saved as well. That's what the meaning, the context shows, that they believed, the house, and they were baptized, and they were all saved. Yeah, fine.
I remember Barbara said that, the Jews, whatever that was. What was that, Barbara?
The males were allowed to divorce, the females weren't. In Greek society, both could.
But Corinth was Greek.
Yeah.
So what I said before, if this was a Greek church members and stuff like that, it throws a different light.
Yes, but the scriptures are the same. You got to follow whether they're Greeks or Hebrews. Yeah.
In Corinth, we were studying the book of Acts, and there were at least two, it seems like, synagogue leaders that were part of that church.
That's right.
so they became
Jews. So they're Jews too.
So there were Jews mixed.
Mixed in the Greeks.
The Jews had a lot of influence.
Yes. All right, what verse are we on now?
15. We did 14, so we said 15.
The children be holy. Okay. Okay, well, I think we're finished, I think, with 14. But if the unbelieving depart, what should be true?
Depart.
Let it depart. Now, what does it mean, a brother or sister is not? Who's a brother, who's a sister?
The Christian.
Christian. Save man or save woman. Not under bondage in such cases. There's that word bondage.
Yes, the verse Paul was talking about.
Paul was talking about that. Now, what does that mean?
They don't have to stay together. They can't force the person to stay.
They're not forced. But what do some people interpret this bondage to mean?
They can get married.
They're free to remarry. That's right. But I don't believe that's the meaning at all. They're not, in other words, they're not going to force their husband to stay or the wife to stay. They want to depart? Let them depart. That's what I believe this means about the bondage. Although some interpret it otherwise. Now, in other words, are all the Bible-believing Christians agreed on divorce and remarriage?
No.
In fact, most of them say, teach what?
The exception clause.
Except, which is, of course, in Matthew with the betrothal. Has nothing to do with marriage today. In Matthew 6 and Matthew 19.
That
That's what Dr. Custer taught.
Oh, yes. See, and that's what we're taught at Dallas Theological Seminary. In other words, unfaithfulness on the part of the husband or wife, get a divorce, remarry, no problem. But we don't believe that that's true. And they use Matthew. Keep your place here. Let's go to Matthew chapter 6 to show what this means. Matthew chapter 6. Somebody find the verse for us.
6 what?
Well, that's what I said. Somebody find the right verse. Whoever gets there first.
You mean Matthew 5:32?
Yeah.
Oh, 5. I'm sorry. 5:31-32. All right.
But I said to you that whosoever shall put away his wife, save for the cause of fornication, cause of her to commit adultery, whosoever shall marry her, that is divorce, committeth adultery.
All right. Now, what was true of the Jewish customs in this day that Matthew's referring to?
Betrothal.
What was betrothal? Jewish betrothal.
It's stronger than engagement.
Strong engagement. What was true? What happened at that time?
It was a legal thing.
Yes. What was the case in Mary and Joseph? What were they?
Betrothed.
What did they call each other in Scripture? Husband and wife. Were they married as we talk of marriage today? No. Betrothal. He was minded to put her away. What does that mean?
He thought about divorcing her.
Remember, then the betrothal, they weren't even married. This betrothal divorce is different than our kind of divorce regularly. Yeah, Anna?
Wasn't it also called espousal?
Yes, espousal or betrothal. Yes.
He's espoused
to Joseph. Yes, Vaughn?
Sometimes, I read this, maybe all the time, the woman, like Mary, she would go live in the father's house of the man that she's was espoused to. They didn't come together, but she actually went there and lived in that place. That's why Mary and Joseph were together and going to Bethlehem together.
Yes, well, I don't know about that, but all I know is they were espoused. They had no sex relations prior to the marriage.
They were together.
Now, in Matthew chapter 5,
Take a step back, Matt. If they were in the Father's house, perhaps they were dwelling in the same house, but they weren't living together.
No, they weren't living then.
I mean,
you could clarify it, because I just learned this in later years.
Yeah, well, I don't know where you got that, but I never heard that in my life. But Pastor Dan is correct. They were not living together, having sex together. She did mention that to Anna.
I suppose it depends whether you're using the strictly literal definition of living together, or the connotative meaning of living together.
Yes.
Well, I mean, in today's age,
the same house.
When somebody says we're living together,
right,
it means the same house. No, mom.
In today's age. In today's age.
But mom didn't think of it today. She thinks it's another time. Just living.
I'm living with my parents.
Yes, that's right.
Well, that's good to point it out.
Okay, that's good. Now, getting back to Matthew 5, verse 32. If this is espousal, this is not marriage, I say unto you, whosoever shall put away his wife, is that real wife or just a spouse wife? A spouse wife. They're not married. This is a spousal. Same for the cause of fornication. Now, can married people commit fornication?
Yeah.
Can married? No, they can't. There'd be adultery. A person that's married, has sex with a man, he is or she is committing adultery. See, this has nothing to do with married people. Now, furthermore, it says in verse 31, 32, same because of fornication, causeth her to commit adultery. What is adultery?
Sexual morality.
With married people. But see, even though they were betrothed, this is still called adultery or fornication. In other words, it's the marriage, this espousal was just like a married husband and wife, they're called. Commit adultery, whosoever shall marry her, divorce, commit adultery. So, now the thing, the problem I have with these people that taught me at Dallas Seminary and all the other people that believe that you, that the fornication or infidelity or something else breaks the marriage, how can you have in the same verse fornication and adultery? You can't have it both ways. Fornication, single. Adultery, married. See, it's impossible. So anyway, but this is what people are teaching. The same is referred to in chapter 19, verses 3 to 11. The same thing is considered. But that Matthew was the Jewish law of betrothal. And Mary and Joseph were under that law, and they were betrothed. They were not married. Oh, excuse me, John, go ahead.
Who were your teachers at Dallas that taught you?
Well, Dr. Evans taught me, Walward, all of them, all the whole teacher, that's what they taught. And people that come visiting Bible lectures, they all taught that. That's what they teach. See, I was taught by our pastor when I was first saved at the Berea Baptist Church, Berea, Ohio. And Pastor Willis was a different fellow because he taught very clearly. Marriage is for life, and marriage is not an excuse for it. And it's not a question of somebody's unfaithful. You just all of a sudden get a divorce, you get remarried. He didn't teach that at all. It's for life. And he taught this about this betrothal situation. He taught the betrothal just as it is, like I've been teaching now. And that's not the Jewish betrothal is not the same as marriage today. So this verse, both in chapter 5 of Matthew and also chapter 19, doesn't apply to what they apply to it today. All right, anyhow, what verse are we on now?
15.
All right, let the unbelieving depart. If the unbelieving depart, what should be happening then?
Let him go.
Let him go. Let him depart. Brother Chester, he said, not a Christian boy, man or a Christian woman, not under bondage. In other words, they're not required to force him to stay. Bondage is that to force him to stay in such cases. But God has called us to peace. Why do you think that's in verse 15?
Don't fight about it.
Don't fight about it. Just let them go. And then in verse 16, we read 16, didn't we? And what knowest thou, O wife? What will possibly be happening if you?
Their husband gets saved.
He may be saved. In other words, and then how knowest thou, O man, if he's the Christian?
And save
the wife could come to the Lord and be saved. And so, the unbelieving depart, let them depart. In other words, he's hopeful that these homes will be reconciled, both will become Christian. As Rob Winograd mentioned in 1 Peter 3:1, be won by the conversation, the manner of life of their wives. That the husband will be won. That's what he means there. Save their wife. In other words, lead to their salvation. Not that the wife and anybody can save another person, but in the sense of lead them to Christ and so that Christ can save them. Did we read 17?
I don't think so.
No,
all right, let's read 17, 18, and 19 together. But as God hath distributed to every man, as the Lord called everyone, so let them walk, and so ordain I in all churches. As any man called being circumcised, let him not become uncircumcised. As any called uncircumcision, let him not be circumcised. Circumcision is nothing, but uncircumcision is nothing, but the keeping of the commands of God. Let every man abide. Did we read?
We read 17, 18.
Oh, 17, 18. I'll stop there. God distributed every man. What do you think that means? as God has distributed to every man.
Perhaps even of marriage.
Could be married, as the Lord hath called everyone. In other words, the way he's been called, man or woman, what should be the case? Let them walk. In other words, if they're called to be single, let them be single. If they're called to be married, let them be married. In other words, whatever the gift that God has distributed, let them walk accordingly. And what did he do with it? Did he teach this only in the church of Corinth?
Everywhere.
All the different churches, wherever he went, Ephesus and Colossae and Philippi and all, Thessalonica, all the churches. Then in verse 18, here's another situation. What's a person called here being circumcised? What religion would he be normally? But of course today, they circumcise everybody, Gentiles and Jews. But now, they've got a different rule. I understand some of the doctors realize that that's not the best thing to do, and so they're not pushing this circumcision for babies anymore. There's a big fight about the big battle. But in the early days, for many, many years, they just did it. That's it. Doctors circumcised boy babies. That's it. And regardless. But now there's a debate. Some do and some don't. Some are for it, some are against it. There's a fight among the medical world on that. But the Jewish, that always did. The Jews circumcised. What day of the eighth day? They circumcised the boy babies.
Do you know why?
It has nothing to do with the blood.
Your blood clots on the eighth day at the best time it ever does in your whole life.
Is that right? Mm-hmm. That's the reason for that. That's good. The clotting of the blood. And so a brother or sister not under bondage, and now verse 16, 17, we're at 17. No, 18. A called circumcised. What should be true if a man is called being circumcised or a Jewish person? That's right. And in that case, maybe don't live like the Gentiles live. In that sense, I don't think you're uncircumcised physically, but don't live like the Gentiles, uncircumcision, that type of thing. Let him not be circumcised. Let him not be. If he's called uncircumcision, let him not be what?
Circumcised.
So in other words, whether it's the life that they live or whether it's the physical circumcision, one thing is, you know, they're just stay in the same calling which you were. Don't be moving around, jostling yourself in all directions. Then in verse 19, what does God think about circumcision itself?
Nothing.
What does he think about uncircumcision?
Nothing.
But what?
Keeping the commandments
of God. That's the important thing to do, to keep God's words. Can you keep what you don't know?
No.
No, you can't. So we got to know the words of God. And be very strong in that, and then keep them. And then we read 20, didn't we?
No.
No.
We were going to, but that would have been.
Oh, that's right. Well, that would be a terrible error, wouldn't it? sin. Okay, go to purgatory. Let's read 20, 21, and 22. But every man abide in the same calling wherein he was called. Art thou called, being a servant, care not for it. But if thou mayest be made free, use it rather. For he that is called in the Lord, being a servant, is the Lord's freeman. Likewise also, he that is called, being free, is Christ's servant. Ye are bought with a price, be not the servant of men.
That's four.
Oh my, I did it again. How about that?
We're having a bad day.
It's a short one. Bad
day,
right? Right to it.
Okay, all right, so let's go now. Verse 20, what does God say in this verse? What does he mean? Abide.
Stay in the same.
Whatever calling it is. If you're married, stay married. If you're not married, whatever the calling of the Lord is.
And that would be your obedience.
That'd be obedience. That's right. That's obedience. Then he lists some of these callings. First of all, verse 21, called being a servant. What would that mean today, you think? Called being a servant.
A worker,
working for somebody, some company or some church, whatever it may be. Care not for it. What does care in that sense mean?
Don't be concerned.
Don't be concerned. Don't be worried. Don't be upset. But if thou mayest be made free, what does that mean?
Slaves could buy the freedom.
Slaves could buy the freedom. In this case, this servant could be a slave. See,
or
doulos.
Be set free.
He could be set free. Anna's our scholar in the Greek department. She's looking up to see what this Greek word is. Probably doulos is the word, which means a bond slave. a servant rather than diakonos, which is just a normal kind of servant. So if you can be made free, and if there were slaves and made free, what then should be the case?
Use it,
rather. In other words, if you can stay in the same calling, not try to run away. What, Anna, what's your, is it doulos?
Yes, doulos.
Oh, okay, I thought it was, thank you. She's looking up. It's a bond slave. So these were people in slavery.
What verse are we on?
Verse number 21.
The word servant.
The word servant. Yeah. He is a servant. Is it 21? Yeah, 21. Care not for it. In other words, stay right there. A lot of people are trying to leave their servitude and get free and so on, but Paul just said to stay right there. But if you're made free, though, use it. Use your freedom to take care of things. Then in verse 22, what is true of the one that's called, who's being a servant or a slave? If he's a saved person, what does that mean?
He's a freeman.
He's a freeman in the Lord, isn't he? He's the Lord's freeman, called being a slave. What does that mean, the Lord's freeman? What does that mean?
He's serving the Lord.
Serving the Lord.
And not man.
If the Son will make you free, shall be free indeed. Free. Fine, Anna.
Well, the Lord's freeman, wouldn't that indicate like a paid servant as opposed to a slave?
Could be. But at least there wouldn't be any longer a slave in the slave market. And it's interesting. But being called, being free, what is true of a person that's free after he's the Lord saved him? In verse 22, he's Christ's servant. What's that word? Probably the same word, doulos. Huh?
Maybe.
Whole body, so we assume, but our guess would be it would be doulos. Whoops, you all right? So the Lord's servant. In fact, remember when Paul writes certain letters, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, remember as he, at the beginning of the different letters, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, that word is doulos, that's a slave, a bond slave. And what is one of the things that we do, what is slaves supposed to do, that word?
Obey their masters.
Obey their masters, do the will of another. Somebody's a servant, a slave, does the will of another. So it's important. And Anna's going to come up with that.
Christ's servant, that's doulos.
Doulos again, just like we thought. So it's a servant, slave, either Christ's slave or servant. And that's what Paul says. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ in the letters as he writes. Well, let's read 23. I know we read it already, but let's read it again. Oh, excuse me, fine.
I looked up in this blessing book.
All right.
It's a couple of paragraphs, but I'd like to read it on page
okay.
48.
Who wrote that book? Okay.
In time, Joseph.
Nobody saw that hand. Mrs. Waite wrote it. Go ahead.
In times, Joseph and Mary would marry, but when we first meet them, they are only a spouse. An espousal is a legal binding promise between a man and a woman who have been promised to each other for a future marriage union. Joseph was called Mary's husband. Mary was called Joseph's wife. Matthew 1. A dowry, money, and gifts is passed from the intended groom to the intended bride's family to seal the promise. Legal papers are signed. It is as if they were actually married, but do not come together as man and wife till after the wedding ceremony. I read that a young woman who is espoused is taken to live at her intended husband's house or at the house of her husband's father. I am not sure this is true in all cases. There is no sexual union until the actual marriage ceremony. I personally believe that is the reason that Mary was with Joseph when they both went to pay their taxes in Bethlehem. The espousal was different than our engagements. To break this espousal promise, one had to go to law. Such a promise was only broken when there had been fornication on the part of the woman.
Good. You had that right. That's good. All right, we're going to stop right there, but take up verse 23 and following the next Lord's Day, really. But you have other comments or questions before we close?
The Jews yeah. don't actually marry.
They don't?
They have contract.
Uh-huh.
And what we would call the wedding ceremony is they don't marry either each other or are married by the rabbi. They celebrate the contract.
That's the present Jews today. All right, that's interesting. Other comments or questions?
Do they jump over a broom or something?
No, that's Protestants.
Oh. Protestants, okay.
Or were they married years ago, like with Jesus?
It was always contractual. It was never marriage. Greek, what we think of as marriage is strictly a Roman custom, Greek and Roman.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments or questions before we close? Quite found that's close.
That's interesting.
Interesting, isn't it?
I'd like to hear more about that.
Well, do you want to have more questions?
No.
Yeah, I have a question.
Well, when they're married, what do? Do they just have a contract?
It's a contract. Like they bring it up between the parents, and, you know, this is how it's going to go, and then the couple agrees to it or not or whatever, and when everybody's happy, everybody signs the papers, and it's done.
Wow.
So it's like a marriage, like a marriage, but it's a contract.
But it's strictly legal.
Yeah. All right, fine.
Well, like in the Bible, Isaac took his wife, you know, was it Rebecca? It was with Isaac.
Mm-hmm.
And into his tent, and then the other boy, I lost track of him, Jacob, took Rachel in mm-hmm. his tent. It doesn't seem to be any in his
really
mother's
Leah.
Tent.
Leah. He took Leah for him. Yeah.
There didn't seem to be a ceremony of any kind. And I don't know if they signed papers back then or not.
Yeah, they did, because that's when Abraham went looking for his daughter, his son's wife. He had all those gifts and the gold and, you know, 40 camels and whatever.
That's good.
All right.
That's very interesting.
Any other comments or questions?
Would that be the the Jews that are not real biblical, what are those
Reformed,
Jews?
Reformed Jews?
Would that be the same thing?
Rather
they
than Orthodox.
Do they have a wedding ceremony? Do you know?
I can't speak to that.
Just the Orthodox.
Some of them have wedding ceremonies because, you know, I've seen it been done. But it's not like, you know, where they have the tent and they have...
But that's the celebration of the marriage contract.
Oh, they're celebrating it.
That's all it is. Yeah.
But it's
they don't exchange vows.
No, they don't.
No.
Oh, okay.
Good. Any other comments or questions?
It's a legal thing. Mm-hmm. Huh.
Business.
If there are no other comments or questions, let's close the word of prayer.